I am an environmental lawyer, and several years ago, I moved into the direction of international environmental law. I love it. And these are just some perspectives on this problem of ocean acidification that come from the international law world. There are several different portals to thinking about acidification that come from international environmental law. Some of them are sector-based, marine pollution, regimes. Some of them are atmospheric-based, and some of them are just generic, sue the sons of, and arbitrate with them international international law. I've lectured here before for the Newkirk Center, and the Constitution for the kinds of problems we're addressing today is the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. I won't get into details now. I've written about this. You can buy my book on Amazon, too. It's called Environmental Governance of the Great Seas, Law and Effect, and it addresses much more than what I'm saying today. But the Law of the Sea focus is generic enough that it can be an umbrella international initiative to address some of these problems. It has several sections specifically oriented toward the marine environment. It talks about piracy, it talks about mining the nodules of the great seas, but it does have specific provisions on the marine environment. And in relationship to the last question, it does talk about land-based sources of pollution. And this is one of the major concerns with regard to environmental pollution of the oceans in general, but as we've seen today, with regard to the acidification issues. It has several other provisions. One of the provisions that it addresses is the constitutional preamble provision. The articles come together to focus on prevention, control, and reduction of environmental pollution, including pollution introduced through the atmosphere. There are separate sections on the kinds of areas that the senator and others were talking about in Washington State and others mentioned over lunch in the Yucatan area, areas focused on enclosed or semi-enclosed seas. And the Law of the Sea Treaty defines what that means, and it encourages states, nation states in that context, the United States and Canada, the United States and Mexico, Mexico and its Latin American neighbors, to cooperate to develop ways of preventing, assessing, and compensating for damages caused by environmental pollution of the great seas. There are also specific programs under the United Nations Environmental Program, which has a special set of interest in protection of the regional seas. The focus is on environmental cooperation, but it's an opportunity to think about pollution-specific concerns that might not be addressed by other environmental treaties. So in the Mediterranean, for example, the Mediterranean countries have gone well beyond some of the other regional seas areas and have a separate treaty on land-based pollution, where they are now instructing member states to focus on approaches to decreasing pollution from their industries and others. So that's one, that's the Constitution of the Marine set of initiatives on this issue. There are also other specific treaties that address the challenge of acidification. The second major focus is that related to atmospheric pollution. And maybe that's the one that comes to mind most immediately because of our learning this morning of the relationship between greenhouse gas emissions, CO2, and acidification. This is the set of laws that began with the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change and has evolved through the Kyoto Protocol. And the overall goal of this regime, regime meaning a collection of treaties, institutions, and policies oriented toward a particular problem, in our case acidification, to prevent dangerous anthropogenic interference with the climate system, address sources of greenhouse gases and sinks. And this is why we're wondering whether this is an appropriate set of tools to address acidification. Some scholars think it is a good entry point. Others are focusing on some of the countervailing impacts that are associated with implementation of the regime and acidification. For example, the regime talks about sinks, and thinking as recent as the last several years, the idea is to sequester CO2 on the ocean floor. And that, if done well, maybe does not increase acidification, but many slip twixt the cup and the lip. And there are a third set of international environmental laws that are implicated in concerns about the acidification problem are the biodiversity conservation regimes. So international environmental lawyers and scholars talk about this set of activities as clusters or regimes that might be called upon to address the type of problem that we're facing substantively in this conference and the states and the nations are addressing with acidification. But there is also the notion of soft law. And I think Meg referred to this with the precautionary principle, with her reference to precaution. The precautionary principle that is maybe most appropriate in situations where we don't have specific focused scientific information that addresses the cause-effect relationships, but the idea in international law, in evolving understanding, is that nation states, in the absence of certainty, should act in order to prevent any regrets in the future. There are some others as well that are background ideas of aspirations toward achieving a global environmental objective. This is a soft law activity that is moving along quite rapidly to suggesting perhaps some bilateral or multilateral treaties. It's the Coral Triangle Initiative that involves Malaysia, Papua New Guinea, and Indonesia, and other regional partners. I was talking to one of the scientists this morning. This was new to me. The Coral Triangle has some very significant percentage of the important coral reefs in the world. We could talk over coffee about whether it's 60 or 70%, but a large percentage of biodiversity in the world. And these nations, Indonesia being the leader, have identified the serious implications for the economy, tourism, and for their concern with the future of the oceans that are right in their backyards and are moving in a fairly aggressive way to implement some cooperative activities. What is this? This is a Russian doll, and I use this to explain the potential, but also the problem associated with these multiple regimes that nation states, including some nation states that have very limited resources for implementation, are confronted with. Overlapping requirements, the Kyoto, the law of the sea, biodiversity. And so there are opportunities provided by this multiple level of international law. But some scholars even talk about paralysis. Which laws are we supposed to be implementing with what priority? And it sounds to, based on our discussions today, acidification should be one of those priorities. There are also international tribunals where some of these concerns can be addressed. We wonder who's responsible. Under some of these international treaties, was the United States, well, we're not a member of the law of the sea. Did you know that? Everyone wants to be a member of the law of the sea, except I think six senators. The prior presidents, the present president, all but six senators want to be a member of the law of the sea, and somehow they're blocking it. But the law of the sea has an international tribunal for the law of the sea, and one approach would be to suggest to the tribunal that we need an advisory opinion with regard to whether or not these kind of activities are demanded, kinds of activities, control of land-based pollution, other links to acidification, are controlled by the law of the sea regime. We are environmental lawyers, right, Michael?
Indeed.
We have to sue. And of course, we don't have to sue, but there are opportunities for bringing actions at the international level. In a parallel way with other more cooperative approaches. There are many opportunities. I'll just name one. At lunch, I was also informed about the immense value of the reef system in off of Mexico. There are international approaches under the North American Free Trade Agreement for addressing through a submission process, complaints by nation states and individuals and non-governmental organizations within those states that the countries are not enforcing their own environmental laws in ways that might, in our case, lead to acidification. So there are some promising opportunities. Which directions to take, maybe something we'll be able to talk about in the final panel. Thanks.
Question?
I'm interested, Joe, whether you think the Ramsar Convention would be an effective tool for protecting coral reef ecosystems. I know it's been suggested by international scholars as a potentially useful tool.
The Ramsar Convention on the International Protection of the Great Wetlands and Waterfall associated with those wetlands. Correct me if I'm wrong, Meg, but much of that is directed at nation states identifying those wetlands, and some nation states are resistant to do so, and then developing their own management schemes for limiting activity within the wetlands. But I think it certainly is another tool to be added to the toolbox.
More locally here, we have whale migration. And if you go down to the Guerra Negro birthing areas, the Mexicans are very proud that all the California gray whales are birthed in Mexico, which make them dual citizens. They migrate very, very close to our coast here, particularly in Laguna Beach, because we're so deep and so steep that the whales actually come in. So is there some way to use some of this international law to protect the whale habitat? I brought this up during public comment a couple of times at the Coastal Commission just to get on the record. But it would seem that these are listed, protected species and that we should be protecting their habitat if we hope to have them be healthy and viable. So is there any idea about how to apply international law, one? And number two, how do we trigger that from the grassroots level? Because there are a lot of laws that protect the environment, but it's very difficult for grassroots folks to kind of engage those rules and regulations to compel compliance. We're not trying to sue people. What we're trying to do is get into some serious discussions in the settlement negotiations, and often law gets us there faster than other ways. Thank you.
What a great question. I just gave my international law exam, and that would have been a great problem. I would approach it in a couple ways. I think we learned this morning that what is good for biodiversity in a sea is also good for controlling acidification. So the extent that you can use another international treaty, the Convention on the International Trade in Endangered Species, to protect the whale resource, it may also have some positive implications for acidification. The specific concern with whales should be addressed by the obligations that the United States has taken on under the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species through its Endangered Species Act. And so that's a promising possibility.
Thank you, Professor DiMento.